So, Karen, you had actually sent something via the text platform that I think is very prevalent now. Unfortunately, post-pandemic, we're seeing a lot of mental fatigue, post-pandemic fatigue. We're seeing a rise in substance abuse, and but let me go ahead and let you speak a little bit about that.
So since COVID, I noticed that mental illness has escalated. Children who have been online are afraid to go back to school. They fear COVID. Seniors have been isolated. They have been in their house. A lot of them haven't seen their families. And so that was one of the questions, like what resources would be available for those who need to almost re-enter society, for the seniors who are isolated, who are by themselves in their homes, who don't have anybody, and for children who are now afraid to go back to school, even though they are at this time, they are basically mandated to go back to school.
But that doesn't, as you say, that doesn't eliminate the fear or the anxiety. And just as much as we want to address the academic loss, because I know that it's that's something that people like to hear, but yeah, there was an academic loss.
Absolutely, I can attest to that.
Yes, and you
I'm in
are,
the schools right now, and I
yes,
can see definitely that the children are definitely below.
you are an educator.
Yes.
So we know that you know what you're talking about. But in addition, we need to be very cognizant about the mental part of re-entering. So now it's not an option of remote. It's you have to go,
Correct.
despite the anxiety levels, despite the fears, despite whatever it is that's in your mind that you've been living now for 2 years. It's 2 years. So I want to break it down into a couple of different answers. First of all, there is a number that I really want to make sure we get out to the community for anyone in crisis, and that is anyone in crisis. That's a child that may feel in crisis, that may be a senior citizen who feels in crisis, a veteran who's possibly in crisis, and we know every 22 seconds, a veteran commits suicide, and that is just unfathomable to me. So I actually left my phone here because the number, and we had stated this last time, is 988. So I thought, let's do it.
You have reached the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline, also servicing the Veterans Crisis Line. If you are in emotional distress or suicidal crisis, or concerned about someone who might be, we're here to help.
So that is a tool that not enough people know about. It's a
No.
3-digit code, 988. And you see how quickly they answer. And in another few seconds, I didn't want to get somebody on the line and take away from someone that possibly could be in need of their services. As far as our senior citizens, and you know that I've been talking a lot about our senior protection program, and that's multifaceted. We want to make sure that our seniors are not getting scammed. Not every senior is tech savvy. They don't know how to use a computer. Maybe they don't have a smartphone. Some do. So when I am elected, I'm going to utilize the resources that are available. So we'll be able to determine a senior citizen who maybe is somewhat tech savvy but wants to learn more, and we're going to develop a program to help them become a little bit more tech savvy where they can receive a text message on an alert from me, perhaps. What that does is that eliminates mailers. And what does that do? Saves taxpayers money. How many mailers have we all gotten in the last month? Those are millions of dollars. However, there's going to be a demographic of senior citizens that are not going to be tech savvy, that don't have a son, a daughter, a sister, a cousin that lives nearby that's going to be able to advocate for them. We're going to identify those senior citizens, and we're going to do in-person visits. So we're going to do two things. We're going to make sure that they have the information, my office phone number, what to do, and we'll do practice drills with them. We'll pretend we're making a phone call. Hi, this is the IRS. You owe $500,000, and if you don't, we're going to come arrest you. We'll do practice skills with them and make sure that they know what the next step is to do. And there may be senior citizens that will need a mailer, although I feel most of them just go in the garbage. It's a waste to our environment, and we're not getting the message across. So for those individuals, an in-person visit is probably going to be the best course of getting that information to them. Is there anything else that, I think we covered everyone's questions that...
Well, I would like to suggest that maybe the seniors can get together, since I am in the senior community, and support each other. I've done it informally, where I go grocery shopping. I'm in the store 6 o'clock every morning, and I bring back, and not that early, but later in the day, deliver to those who have put in their little needs. Why not?
I think that's a great idea.
But why can't it be done on a community-wide basis?
It can be done.
Rather than just me doing for these.
It can be done, and you'll be my first volunteer, Anne. You just signed up. Thank you so much.
My pleasure, actually.
Did you get that? Anne is the first volunteer.
And I would volunteer to teach them tech savvy, because I do it in school, so I can definitely.
Yes.
And I help my dad, so.
And you know, I always say this. We have such a unique community, and I really do believe that when we put a call out for assistance, so as a legislator, if I put out a call, hey, if anyone has any free time and would like to be part of this program in helping teaching a group of senior citizens how to navigate a smartphone, a tablet, or a computer, I would bet dollars to donuts I would get more volunteers than I probably would have participants. And I think that just speaks to the community and the love of our community, and I think the love that we have for each other as neighbors was wanting to do the best that we can together.
Well, I appreciate you bringing us together here and addressing different concerns from different demographics of people, and to like hear it, and just to have a little feedback, and just to everyone put their little, you know, two cents in, and just to,
yeah.
And it's very nice. So I appreciate you having this today.
Thank you. And you know, I just want to say sometimes, you know, the conversation might not be a pleasant one. It might be someone who's really, really irate, and I'm ready to have that conversation also, because although we've addressed a lot of positive things, there are some really, you know, serious issues. Roads, I know, being one. People are frustrated. Their tire rims are getting destroyed, and they're frustrated and they're angry, and they need to address it to someone. So I want everyone to know that's listening. Listen, it's not always going to be, sunshine and lollipops. And it's going to be sometimes, you know what? You're my legislator. I'm going to hold you to task. And actually, that's what I want. I want to be held to task on all the initiatives that we can do, but some of the complaints. Because if I don't know that there's a problem, I can't fix it. Mm-hmm. So a complaint is never a bad thing. It's an opportunity to fix something. That's how I look at it. So thank you all so much. This was really great. I'm so glad that we had the opportunity to do it. And it's early enough, and it's a beautiful day. So everyone enjoy your day. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.